Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I'm going to finish the tutorial how to fine-tune a image transformer classifier with your own data, and today I will explain you how to create an application which will allow you to move the model to production and do inference in a production environment. This is how I used to do this kind of deployments. How I used to prepare the applications. I used to use some technologies like Docker, FastAPI, and Postman for testing. Yeah, we will go through how I prepare the application, how I create some wrappers, some tips about how I used to do it, and then probably you will get some tips that it will be useful in your deployments. As I said, well, if you saw my previous tutorials, I developed in Python. Most of the code I produce is Python when not PySpark. Sometimes we need to do some refactoring in other languages, but majoritarily, and for based on my experience, for what I see in most of the companies, Python, PySpark. And when we discuss or yeah, how to do us in this case, like what I'm going to show you, a serverless application, we use Python. Yeah, no point on that, because well, it's most of the libraries and technologies work with this language, and cloud providers wise, Google Cloud, Amazon, and Azure, they are using majoritarily Python. I used to use for SID VS Code. It's pretty convenient. It's multiple plugins which connect with any cloud environment, with Docker, with Azure Machine Learning, with Amazon, with whatever you have. There is a plugin which helps you to do quick fast development, and it's, well, in my case, well, it's what I used to use on my databases. Some of the people is they prefer PyCharm, but I also have it. But well, majoritarily I use VS Code. Also, we make a lot of stuff in Azure environment. But well, this is how I used to do things. Again, this is not a master recipe. It's just how I do the things. There is multiple ways to do the same, and then I want to show you how I do it, and you may find this in that is useful. At least it's not, well, it's just want to tell you how I do things and how I can productionize, or I'm going to productionize, the model I was explaining you in the previous tutorials. Also, I used to work in a Windows machine. On the Windows machine, I used to have Windows System Linux as a host environment to test my Dockers and to test my applications, and also it's possible from VS Code to use remote deployment. It's just connecting to the Windows System Linux in your Windows desktop and run from there a VS Code server and run your application. Usually, as you may know, creating an application with a AI component is not more than create an application, a conventional application, but with this specific component, which is a machine learning model. But for the rest, is pure software development. So we keep the software in a repository for tracking, for change control, to create. We used to develop in teams with a branching policy, with some rules how to create the software, how to test it, how to move the different versions to productions, the different releases. But well, this is not the material of this video. It's just I want to tell you with this that this is software development. We follow conventional best practice of software development, but with the particularity that we had an AI component that is part of the application. But at the end of the day, what we are doing is creating an application which wrap the model and make and create some interfaces to interact with the a bigger application. We set up some channels and protocols, how the model is interacting, how the model with the rest of the components, how the model receives the data or receives the information, and how the model return the information, the inference, or whatever is doing your model to other components or to the requester or to the component who requested the inference for the data that sent to the model. And then usually together with Python, I use key components, which is Docker. Docker is a well-known container technology. Well, there is others, but well, the majoritarily is use Docker. Is well, there is plenty of documentation how to work with Docker. Also, it's not the matter of this tutorial how to use Docker. I will show you how create a Docker file for this project. But well, you can go to the documentation and get all the information you need, and also there is plenty of the information online on how to do how to create Docker containers and how to personalize it for your own use. We use FastAPI. FastAPI is a web framework that run in Python. It's a high performance and very fast web application. It's multi-processing and well, it's a state of the art. There is other like Flash, but well, we used to work with FastAPI in all applications, and then well, it's helped us to create the entry points for the application that is going to interact with the model in the background and with the other components of the application, at least in this deployment I'm going to show you here. No, again, there is plenty of documentation in internet how to use it. You will see how I did it in this particular setup. You can find in internet as well plenty of information about how to use this tool. No, and also we use to test all the APIs and all the entry points that we create. We use Postman, also very well known application for testing, to build APIs, and then part of the Swiss knife that we use on a daily basis at the moment to deploy that to productionize any machine learning model. Okay, let's go to the details. Okay, so again, we had everything in our repository. We have our application with this. Images. We handle our application not suitable for work. The minimum components you need to create a Docker is a Python script in this case, which is the entry point of your application. Later on, how you are going to organize the different modules, the different scripts that support the application is not relevant for now. The main is that you need to create is a script that is going to be the entry point of your application, that is going to be the script that it will be run by the Docker once the Docker is started. The Docker at the end of the day is just an image, a virtual machine with an operating system, usually Linux. We will go to that detail later. So usually Well, the script is the entry point script is not more than, well, I called it, and this is a convention. You can use yours, but in my case, I'm just creating a convention to organize myself with the endpoint underscore the name of the model. It's a Python script, and then like any other Python script, it's just, well, you import the libraries you need. You define your environment, and here, well, we start with what is relevant. We create an object, a FastAPI object. This is the web application, and we name it endpoint. Here we just personalize and load the model in this part here. We check it. We have the CUDA available, the GPU. We define a well, this is I will explain you later some object that we create to monitor the status of the jobs when we receive a request. We had a internal process that is monitoring in with the status in which part of the logic is the request, in order to give a feedback to the user who is requested the to do inference with the model. Define some paths where we had the models, because, well, this usually change from local to what you had on the CI/CD pipeline and what you had in production. This used to change, and then we just tailor the path where the application will find the model. The models are not part of the repository, because, as you remember, or you can imagine as well, some of these models are large language models and are huge in terms of the size, and some of them are gigabytes. Non suitable forward is like a 1 gigabyte site, and then it's better not to deploy this to the repository. Just we keep it offline, and then what we are doing, at least in this setup, is copying the models, the trained model, to a block storage, and then mounting a folder into the server or into the Kubernetes cluster to make them available to the Dockers once they run in the production environment. We load the model from the path depending on the environment, and here we start to create the folders or the entry points of the application. The main entry point or the inference entry points, here again, this is my setup. You can change, we call it process, and this is how the entry point of the application. So we receive from, in this case, from the front, we receive a request, and I will show you now how our request in our setup. It doesn't mind that it had to be in your setup. So every endpoint that you define, or every entry point that you define in the FastAPI application, had this special notation, this decoration of every method, and then it's just you define the application, the method supported. In this case is get, in this case is post, and the entry point that you had to query from your request, no? And then we are using asynchronous queries, asynchronous methods, in order to detach the process and free the server to respond other requests that you may do. Just to give you an idea, the Ubicon, which is the server which is running under the hood, is supporting, well, as much as job that your server can start, and then you have a big server, you can set up that you how to say 200 or 300 jobs in parallel, and then this means that you can send all these requests in parallel. Each of them will be handling an inference request at the same time in parallel. So in our case as well, every request is a batch of files, and then I will show you later on how we are handling this. But again, you can have 200 independent processes in your server, and each process will handle a batch in parallel and independently from the rest. No? And then we have helping entry points just to help to check if the Docker is alive. This special entry is to monitor the status of the job, and this is just for testing, for unit testing. No? The main entry point, that is where we receive the request. We receive a request in a POST formular, in a form, and then transform the form to a JSON file. And in this object, we have what the front in our case is sending to us. No? And then just to give you an idea, an example of what we are receiving, I will show you how it looks like a request, a POST request to our entry point. We are sending a JSON object with some metadata, and in this key, in source content in my case, we had the base64 version of the, in this case, of an image. No, we had some other attributes just to understand where the document is in the data lake, the file name, the type, and this is the threshold which decides if the image is safe or not safe for work in an application. And then we had a key, the main key, with these documents, and this is a list of objects with this format, no ID in the source and the rest. No, here you can the content can be an image or can be a video. Later on, the application is able to recognize the content based on the base64 content, and also based first of all on the file type, but secondly I make a second control just to identify correctly the data that I'm receiving from the front. So also, just a note aside, the base64, as you may know, is not the best format to do this, but well, still is not in production. We are thinking different ways to improve this, because yeah, we base64 produce very long files, very heavy, and the transfer this via HTTP or HTTPS through a network is very costly in terms of the time, and also in terms is decreasing and the performance a lot. No? And then we are thinking some ways, but well, for the moment, just for the purpose of this is working. We will see how we improve it this later on. Okay, so we receive an array with a list with the documents with this format, and this is the request that we send to the entry point, to the main entry point. We receive the request, we make some controls, it's not with default, or in case some cases we just raise an exception case that we don't receive the documents, but some of them we defaulted, like threshold, if you don't receive it, we just put it to 0.5. Once we pass all controls, we run the batch in with this method, which essentially is sending the batch to a pool and is treated individually, and this also liberates the process to handle another request. Essentially, this method is from FastAPI. We just say you just specify the function that you want to run in the pool, on the thread pool, and well, you define the parameters that apply to this function. The function itself is just well differentiating what is an image, what is a video, and handling, and well, we extract the video from the content. From the content source content key is in format base64. We transform it back from base64 to bytes. We open the bytes as an image or as a video, and then on we send the video or the image to the model. In the case of the model, we just simply send the image. In case of the video, as you remember from tutorial part 3, we send the different frames that compose the video one by one to the model. This is also, there is room for improvement in this approach, but okay, it's just how we are doing for now, that is still on the process to be productionized. So once this is executed, we receive the data. The data we receive back is the the same list of objects, but instead in the key source content, we return the inference itself. No, if you remember the part number 3, we were returning the 4 images, the probabilities of these images belonging to one of the classes, and also we aggregate some of these classes into a score and decide if the image is suitable or not suitable for work. O sea, this part is the response that we send back to, in our case, to the front, and we show to the user. And here, after we do the inference on the thread pool, we had the data, the list of documents here. In our case, we had a batch, as I said. We had a batch as a small batch of 10 documents. Again, here the documents are very big. We are thinking how to improve this and improve the performance, but for now it's working. You will see an example later. And then on here in this part, we are just simply creating the object that we are going to respond to send back to the user. With an object response, with at the end we are creating a dictionary. We put some how to say information about the request, the data, this list of documents with the inference, the same documents that we received, but with the key replaced with the inference information, and this some information for the front, just to inform them that how many documents we treated from that batch, how many not, and the reason not of why we didn't handle or we didn't try treat the document. We convert the dictionary into a JSONable compatible object, and we return it back with the status to the user. As you see here, I'm introducing everything in a try and a set to capture just to capture any exception that we are not controlling inside the logic that of this entry point. We just simply capture and we send the system stack back to the user for further analysis. This is many times pretty convenient, because as you may know, when you are working in a serverless environment, well, there is multiple Dockers containers that are running in parallel in different places. If you receive, as you will see later in the demo, some information why the application is failing, is speeding up a lot the resolution of problems and the troubles sorting. The final here, the entry point of the application. This is for the moment that you want to run this out in command line. This is the entry point for command line. Here we are just running the ubicon. Ubicon is the server with server application that comes together with the FastAPI, and we are basically running here. We say which script to run. This is the nomenclature is the name of the script. In this case, endpoint underscore and non-suitable or non-safe for work, and the name of the FastAPI application. If you remember here, app, the name of the application is endpoint. And also every entry point is defined with the endpoint and the method, and later the path inside the application which is going to respond, no? So we say the name of the application, the script and the application that the Ubicon server is going to run, the IP address, usually localhost, but you may have another requirement, usually is localhost, the port and the log level, usually info, you can say the book or another log level, depending on the requirement of your application. There is other parameters that you can take a look to the documentation. So, well, the basic ones just to run the application are the those that you see here on the screen. Later, you create a Docker. You create the Docker. The Docker, if you are familiar with Docker, this, as you may see, this is pretty simple Docker file. It's just a language how to create an image of an operating system and well, copy update the operating system, copy some libraries, copy the software, and run a command just when the operating system stand up, no? Expose as well the ports, because this is telling the Docker container server, the container server, which port is going to use this application to be interrogated, no? And well, let's go line by line. Here we are saying that we use a Docker images. This is a precompiled image which contains a slim version of the Python 3.11. This usually is, I don't remember when, is an Ubuntu 22.04. We just run the or is Ubuntu with this command, is it can be Ubuntu or Debian or Debian derivative. We run update, we run install with Python PIP and some of the library that we need for video and image inference. This is a library in C or C++, so we install it with apt-get install. In that case, we define the working DIT, we copy the requirement txt. Requirement txt is just the libraries that you need to install in Python to run your application. Transformers, Ubicon, FastAPI, Unicom, Pillow, well, all the application that you need, probably some of them you need it, but well, it's all the Python libraries that you need to install to run your application. Here we install the Python libraries, and here I'm installing separately PyTorch with the CUDA with the GPU support. We copy the software. So everything that we had in the app we copy to the Docker. We expose the port and we call the command ubicon with the entry point similar. This is the format that we run the a command into once the Docker is start up, no? And then it's exactly the same that you did here, but in Docker format. Okay, so at least in VS Code, I don't remember it in PyCharm it's the same, but here in VS Code you had some plugins. One of them is to work with Dockers. and it's pretty convenient because, well, you have integrated directly in your IDE. Just you right click on the Docker file and you can build the image either local or in your image repository, in this case in Azure. This project is running in Azure as well, so you can directly build it directly from here, no? So you also have here a list of the dockers that you had running, the images that you had in your repository, in your local repository, and the registries where you are connected. Let's build the image. It's gonna be fast because the docker is already created, so it's going to take the layers and everything from the cache. It's going to run very fast. But well, I will make a pause, and when it's finished I will be back. Well, this is done. It was very quickly, as I mentioned. Well, as you can see, it's the docker build, which is the command that is executing when you do right click and build the image. It's just following sequentially the commands that you write in your Docker file, and then on execute what you are doing. And then this is, as I said before, you are pulling this from the Docker Hub, this image, which is public. You can get it for free. It's nothing special on that. And then once you pull it, it start the image, and you start to update the system. You define the working disk, you copy the files, you install the libraries, you install torch, you copy the software, you expose the dockers, and you run the that. This is only working when you run the docker. So let's see now how to run the docker. So you can go here, click. So I have it now working. I use as well here Docker Compose in our pipeline, the deployment pipeline. We later execute as well the Docker Compose. I will show you now this. Here, as you see, as we change the tag of the non-suitable for work image, is recreating the Docker. So the Docker Compose essentially is a file with the create all the dockers in a single process, no? You define all the dockers that you want to create with the same with the name of the image, is what you had in your docker, what you create in your docker file, the ports, the network where they are going to run, some kind of environment variables, support for GPU case that you need, etc. But it's just a file where you define how many dockers are part of the composite build, no? And then what is producing this? Well, first of all, if you create individually, you just create a new image here on the image tag. And what I did before, running a Docker Compose, is creating all the images that are defined on the Docker Compose file. And then here, as you see here, we create this image and started 1 minute ago. You can go to the image, the application just started. You can go to the machine itself, to the operating system, and you can see here the software that was copied from your repository or your local environment to the Docker. You see here this structure. Probably we can delete. It's just exactly the content of this APP file. Probably I need to include here some commands to delete what is not really necessary, but well, for now we can delete this. This is not necessary for the application. This one as well, data not necessary, and probably keys. Well, many of these can be deleted and not been especially at the end on the production application. But well, as you see here, the Docker is running, and now we can start testing. For to do that, you can use a Jupyter notebook as we do before, or you can use Postman. We used to use Postman because, well, you can define here multiple tests, multiple calls or requests to the entry point. Here we define basically always one, which is the health check. It's just telling us that the sorry, that's not, this is the external, but well, later on we health check, which is the call to the to check if the Docker is alive. And as you can see here, we have, this is just a printout, probably you will see here in the endpoint. This, many of these things, we will remove it once the Docker is in production. We just want to know if some of the stuff is working, no? And this is where it's looking for the models, the Docker in this environment. This is the local models variable. And then well, here we are just logging the get to the health check point. No, this is exactly the request that we make here. And you here see on this tag the answer of the Docker. Here we just send an image. Again, you can see it's going to take a while. As I said before, the Base64 is not very efficient, it's taking a while. But you see here the response of the Docker, of the model itself. And as I mentioned before, in the content, we are just simply returning the NSFW score, the probabilities of the returned by the from the model with the after the inference, and the same content we received from initial request. And also, as I say you before, tell you before, we have some other attributes. In this case, again, it's not a master receipt. This is how we agreed to do it in this project. No? So we had in this case for batch, we define how many documents we treat, not treated, and you will see now in the request when we produce forcibly an error that what we return. For example, here we are testing a failure on the interface. We are provoking this, and as I told you before, we are sending the system stack, and you can follow, or the person which is receiving the error is probably able to follow what is the problem. No, is we are sending a 500 error with the stack, and then you can see here you follow the code. You are familiar with the bug in Python code. You can see here that is failing here. We are trying to send the length of these keys, these two keys, is source content. We intentionally put here a null just to provoke the error and test that the application is capturing the section and writing correctly and returning correctly the stack to the user. Here we had other type of error control. For example, here we are sending a forbidden or a extension that we usually don't treat, and then we are just returning that the document was not treated. No, and why was not treated? Because the file type was not valid. This is how we set that in this project. We return the ID and the reason on not treatment. Here we do the same when there is no data, meaning that the there is something on the content, but it's not suitable to do inference for that. No, it's different that the null when it's no content at all. In this case, we have content. We can put whatever you want here. Let's put whatever. We send it, and then Well, here we produce an error. By the way, okay. The purpose of this other test was just to say that there is no content on the image. Yeah, exactly. This is something that probably I will need to review. But well, this is Daret. Many times you discover bugs as soon as you are explaining the process. And before to see the video, you see that the Docker is returning and logging what you are requesting. You can see on the logs of the Docker. And now we send a video. It's the same content, same format, the request, but the content is a video. If the image was long, large file, the image, the video is huge. So that's why we are thinking a more efficient way to do this. That potentially what we are thinking is just send this URI and read directly from the lake and avoid to send this content over HTTP, which is really not efficient. Essentially what is not efficient is sending it base64 because it's transforming the binary content of the image and or the video into a stream format, which is base64, and this is producing a huge request, very very heavy, and then it's taking a lot of time to send it over HTTP. And secondly, it's an unnecessary process because we had to convert it into base64 and we had to convert it back to binary before entering the neural network, no, before entering the model. Here the same, the model already respond, and the same prediction, description and non-suitable for work. Well, this is how we agree to send this to the back to the front. And here as well the Docker log the process. Here the video had 901 frames and it took 48 seconds to process it. Okay, this is how we test, how I tested it local. Then on we had a CI/CD deployment where in this case we are using Azure DevOps, and then on part of the DevOps pipeline is run this Docker Compose. This Docker Compose contains, is pretty similar to the local, but just contains different paths again, because in production, at least in this case, we are just copying the models to a blob in the data lake, and we are mapping the blob into a folder in the Kubernetes server, and then on we are pointing directly to that folder when we are running the application in production. But for the rest is identical to what we have in local. We also had this variable to just decide that to make the environment understand that when we are local or not in local. This means that we are not in local, and well, the application and the pipeline behavior is slightly different, but essentially the way of work is different. So this finally ends in a Kubernetes server, and we had as well some Postman test to just test the external interface, and you can see here this is a publish ID, and well, you see the model, the machine is quite fast in that case, or faster at least than my local environment, and well, answer quicker than the local server. Okay, that's all. Thank you for watching, and thank you for listening to me. And if you like the content, give me a like and subscribe to my channel if you didn't do it before. Thank you.